Good afternoon, everybody. It is it's great to be here. I want to thank you, Carmel, for your introduction. I want to thank CAP, the Center for American Progress, for inviting me here today and hosting this very, very important discussion. I'm not sure there's a more important discussion that we could be having at this particular time. I want to thank you, Carmel, for joining us recently at the Democracy Reform Task Force to present some of the work that CAP's been doing, and of course today is another occasion to release some important information that's relevant to this topic of conflicts of interest. And I also want to thank Liz Kennedy for her great work and her continued support. I'm looking forward to the discussion today from Ambassador Eisen and Robert Wiseman and Vikram Singh. We've got a terrific panel that we're looking forward to. So here's where I'm going to start this this discussion. Donald Trump told the American people that he was going to look out for us, that he was going to fight for us. That's what he said. A little over 4 weeks ago, it seems like eons ago, but 4 weeks ago, I sat there on the west front of the Capitol and I heard the president make a very important and central promise to the American people. Here's what he said. For too long, a small group in our nation's has reaped the rewards of government while the people have borne the cost. Washington flourished, but the people did not share in its wealth. Politicians prospered, but the jobs left and the factories closed. The establishment protected itself, but not the citizens of our country. That all changes, he said, starting right here and right now. Because today we are not merely transferring power from one administration to another or from one party to another. We are transferring power from Washington, D.C. and back to you, the people. That's what he said at his inauguration. Now, I trust that most of you in this room, when you heard that promise, and I think many Americans, when you heard it, it rang hollow. You saw it for what it was, rhetoric that was designed to distract from what we now see are the president's real motives. You were right to be wary of that promise. President Trump does not appear to be transferring power to the people. What he seems to be doing is pulling the power closer to himself, to his family, to his brand, to his business, and to his buddies. He's broken from all precedent, as Carmel alluded to a moment ago, by entering office with a sprawling web of business assets and conflicts of interest, all too eager, it seems, to subordinate the office of the presidency to the interests of the Trump organization. He has flouted the Constitution by receiving numerous emoluments, both foreign and domestic, and will continue to do so should he not take meaningful steps to relinquish ownership of business assets, and he's shown no inclination to do that. And he has been unrepentant in repeatedly refusing to adhere to the basic norms of integrity that have always governed our nation's highest office, even rebuffing the chorus of Americans of all political stripes who are asking that he release his tax returns, a minimal expression of acknowledgement and appreciation of these basic standards. To make matters worse, the president has surrounded himself, we're pretty much through the cabinet appointment process at this time, with a cabinet full of senior officials who themselves appear to be rife with similar conflicts of interest, taking a cue from the top. And they're primed to capitalize on their newfound positions of power. These are not the actions of a man committed to giving power back to the people or to lifting up the voice of the voiceless who feel left behind by a broken system in Washington. But the reason I read the president's words at the outset from his inauguration is I wanted to ground the discussion here today to remind each of us, the assembled experts, the press, concerned citizens, that out in the country, his promise to give power back to the powerless and the disrespected, to give a voice to the voiceless, still has great resonance and appeal. And the truth is that if people believe he's making good on that promise, then his ethical lapses and his conflicts of interest will be viewed as tolerable. For those who seek to preserve our democracy and the ethical norms and laws which undergird it, this is our challenge. For standing in the public that President Trump's contempt for basic standards of trust and integrity is not trivial. It is not a harmless sideshow. Rather, it strikes at the core of his ability to serve the people. It harms their interest, the public interest. Now, a lot of ink has been spilled and will probably continue to be spilled chronicling the president's breathtaking number of conflicts. Let me just cite a few for the record. His $940 million loan from the Bank of China, his unknown level of foreign investment from Russian oligarchs, his pending trademark litigation in China, his business partnership with the newly named special envoy from the Philippines, appointed by the brutal president, Rodrigo Duterte, his sons, both sons' continued pursuit of business deals every day, it seems, is another one, around the globe, with the imprimatur now of the United States government being placed on those ventures. His many business assets in Turkey, the United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia, and elsewhere, all of which have the potential to distort the president's official actions. The list goes on. Some Americans, including my own constituents for sure, are very closely tracking this. I mean, every news story that comes out that sheds light on the president's conflicts of interest, they're watching this. They're deeply concerned about his cabinet officials and the policy that he might pursue. But many, and certainly it seems the vast majority of Republican voters, are not yet concerned by these conflicts. He may be a scoundrel, some people might say, but he's our scoundrel. No surprise, then, that my colleagues in Congress on the other side of the aisle have been unwilling to engage in meaningful oversight of the new administration. But here's the point we need to make, and I really want to emphasize this. President Trump is not just suffering from petty lapses that will somehow come out in the wash over time. Instead, his complete disregard for ethical norms and the constitutional protections against corruption, if unchecked, will cause grave harm to our nation as a whole and to the situation of everyday Americans. His conduct threatens to weaken our national security, to corrode people's faith in our institutions of democracy, and to advance special interests at the expense of the public interest. Put bluntly, the president is breaking his promise. He is aggrandizing power to himself, not transferring it back to the American people. That is why discussions like the one being held today are so important. We must begin to bring clarity to how President Trump's corruption affects, how it harms the interests of regular Americans. Otherwise, they'll give him a pass, and our call to arms will be just an academic exercise. Released today by the Center for American Progress, written by Liz Kennedy and Danielle Root, lays bare the risk posed by Trump's many conflicts of interest and those of his cabinet. It details how those conflicts of interest are a risk to national security, to U.S. foreign policy, to the integrity of U.S. elections, to the free and fair operation of U.S. economic markets, and to the dedication to the public interest and the rule of law. To reiterate, we must embrace an analysis of the president's conduct that makes clear that his conflicts and those of his cabinet do in fact harm the public interest. This paper, and I hope the discussion that follows today, will help make the turn in the public debate from an ever-expanding laundry list of jarring conflicts to a more sober analysis of how those conflicts imperil the interests of American households and the broader public interest. This is critical, and I applaud the Center for American Progress for its work. I want to offer a sober reminder about the role of congressional oversight, picking up on my earlier comments. President Trump has been president for a little over a month, and it's important to remember there are 47 months to go. So pace yourselves. While Republican leadership has been reluctant to engage in any meaningful oversight of the conflicts that I've discussed and we'll hear more about today, the politics of the moment are not static. Just this week, Americans across the country, as you know, have been flooding town halls, urging their representatives to take oversight of the administration seriously. Members of Congress who ignore those calls do so at their own peril. And again, I firmly believe the more the public focuses on the specific harm of Trump's conflicts, the more that pressure will build. As the current chair of the House Democracy Reform Task Force, I can assure you House Democrats will be at the forefront in exposing the risks that President Trump's conflicts present. We are already pursuing remedies that can bring about the oversight that is demanded. Democrats this week in the House Judiciary Committee will vote on a resolution of inquiry from my colleague Jerry Nadler that would begin investigations into the Trump administration's conflicts of interest and potential improper ties to Russia. Republicans are likely to block this effort, but they'll have to explain if they do. In the same vein, many of my colleagues have authored legislation that would require President Trump to release his taxes, thereby offering a full picture of his finances and sources of conflicts. The task force is also making plans to go outside the Beltway, holding field hearings across the country on these issues, and allowing Americans of all political stripes to learn more about the risks that we face. The paper that you've released today will be very important to that effort. And finally, we're working daily with our standing committees in the House and our partners in the Senate to monitor emerging risks and to seek answers from the administration when appropriate. President Trump promised at his inauguration to give power back to the powerless and to give a voice to the voiceless. Americans must insist that he follow through on that promise, and if he doesn't follow through, they have to hold him accountable. With reports like the one being released today, we can empower Americans to judge for themselves. In other words, let's give people the information. Let them draw the conclusion about whether the president is operating with divided loyalties, whether he's looking out for the people or he's looking out for himself. I want to finish today by reading an excerpt from a book called Lincoln on Leadership by Donald Phillips, a couple paragraphs which I think can kind of drive home the point of this integrity. So I'm going to put my glasses on for this part. The moniker Honest Abe was resurrected for the presidential campaign in 1860. A major component of the Republican campaign hype, it was plastered on campaign posters and appeared in cartoons and newspapers across the country. It was all part of a national crusade that painted Lincoln as one of the common people, a rail splitter from Illinois who was honest beyond question. It has remained in the American stream of consciousness to this day as perhaps the most glorified part of the Lincoln myth. But as American philosopher William Ernest Hocking noted, there are myths which displace truth, and there are myths which give wings to truth. In this case, Abraham Lincoln's reputation for honesty and integrity, even though challenged over the years, has remained unblemished. In fact, as knowledge is gained about the real man, it is largely enhanced. Myth, in this case, has become reality. Lincoln was just as honest as he has been purported to be, if not more so. Without question, honesty is one of the major qualities that made him a great leader. The architecture of leadership, all the theories and guidelines, falls apart without honesty and integrity. It's the keystone that holds an organization together. Tom Peters reported in his research that the best, most aggressive, and successful organizations were the ones that stressed integrity and trust. Without doubt, he stated, honesty has always been the best policy. Managers do things right, leaders do the right thing. And James McGregor Burns warned, divorced from ethics, leadership is reduced to management and politics, to mere technique. That's good stuff. Reading that, looking at our history, I'm convinced that there resides deep in the psyche of the American people an abiding appreciation of integrity and honesty in their leaders. Depart from that on occasion, and the people can forgive. Make it your operating procedure to dissemble and and the consequence can and should be severe. Americans need to ask very simply, whose side is the president on? And can we trust him? Their answer to that question will decide his political fate. Thank you.